what is hypotony? By the statistical definition says that an intraocular pressure of less than 6.5 millimeter mercury would be considered as hypotony. But if you see the clinical definition, so any intraocular pressure that can cause a decrease in vision could be considered as hypotony. And the incidence, if you see, it varies between 1 to 32%. So this depends upon the technique, the concentration, and the duration of mitomycin. So for example, if you see the tube versus trap study, the incidence is around 13%. And here they used MMC with the highest concentration and for the longest duration. Whereas in the collaborative initial glaucoma treatment study, the incidence was slightly less at 9%. That's because they had used 5U for augmentation. The big question is when to intervene. The intervention, it depends upon the cause of the hypotony and the extent of the problem. Generally, it is stratified. You can stratify the hypotony into early and late. So if it occurs less than 2 weeks, we call it as early hypotony. And the most common causes for this are bleb leak and overfiltration. And here you see a shallow chamber. And whereas the late hypotony is that which develops after 2 weeks. And the most common conditions for the late hypotony are hypotonous maculopathy and the late bleb leak. And here, most of the time, you see a deep anterior chamber. If you go into the mechanisms of hypotony, it could be either increased outflow as occurring with overfiltration or with the leaking bleb, or it could be because of a decreased aqueous production. You can have the main causes are iridocyclitis and patient continuing glaucoma medication. This is an important thing to remember because some patients do continue the anti-glaucoma medications and the tablets, the astrazolamide tablets, following the surgery. And this could be the reason for the hypotony. And very rarely it could be because of chemical toxicity to the ciliary body because of the antimetabolites. In early hypotony, the most common cause is, it could be a bleb leak. So the bleb leak could be either from the wound or it could be because of a buttonhole in the conjunctiva. The management of bleb leak, it depends upon the size of the defect and the amount of the leak. So whether it's active or a slow egress or an intermittent leak. So if the defect is small, you can just observe for 3 to 4 days and then but usually what I do is to use a bandage contact lens and place it such that it covers the area of the leak. And at the end of 5 days, you can just remove and do the seedles again and see if there is a leak. But if there is a large and an active leak, you need to resuture the buttonhole or the at the junction, the wound junction. The other important cause is overfiltration. So unlike in bleb leak where there is a seedles positive, here the seedles is not positive. You see a large overhanging bleb. The most common cause for this is because of your loose scleral flap sutures. If you have not tied it tight enough, then there can be excessive flow and this can result in overfiltration. The other important cause that could result in overfiltration is because of the early suture lysis, or you release a suture and just because the pressure is slowly rising up, you try to release a suture or cut the suture and then there is a drop in intraocular pressure resulting in hypotony. So here the chamber will be very shallow, there would be a large diffuse bleb and the seedles is negative. So in overfiltration too, you need not have to jump into some intervention. You can observe for if the chamber is somewhat formed, you can observe. And other conservative measure is by reducing the topical steroids, because this can, you just want to induce the inflammation and cause a conjunctival fibrosis to happen. And this can reduce the bleb size and help the chamber to form, and the pressure also will slowly rise up. Aqueous suppressants, some people try when the pressure is not so low. The idea is because this reduces the aqueous production, so the amount of aqueous reaching the bleb would be less. Atropin eye ointment you have to give, because this will help to keep the chamber formed, because by relaxing the ciliary muscle, the zonules get tightened and the whole lens, iris, diaphragm, it moves backwards. The other way of managing is the conservative measure is by using viscoelastic injection. Heavy viscoelastic like Helon can be injected into the anterior chamber as an office procedure. Here you can see in this video, sodium hyaluronate is taken, and under aseptic precautions, through the temporal paracentesis, what you have done at the time of your trab, through that you can just inject viscoelastic into the anterior chamber. Do not overfill it, just enough to form the chamber, to keep the chamber formed. You can use, an assistant can help you to just push the piston, or you can do it yourself. Then the other method is by reducing the height of the bleb by using these compression sutures. This is a different technique where the sutures are taken through the conjunctiva and it is passed through the scleral flap, and then it comes out, and then you can make, you can put as many sutures as you like. And depending upon the pressure, you can, if the pressure is very high, you can cut off a few sutures too. Because of the bleb leak and the overfiltration, you get a serous choroidal detachment. There's nothing to worry about this, because it's not vision threatening, though it temporarily causes a reduction in vision. The main thing is you need to differentiate from the most important complication, that's the suprachoroidal hemorrhage. The risk factors for a serous choroidal detachment are hypertension, older age, prior vitrectomy, nanophthalmus, and conditions which increase the episcleral venous pressure, such as Sturge-Weber's. The conservative measures for managing the choroidal detachment would be by just using topical steroids and then forming the chamber with atropine ointment. The other measures, I mean, if the choroidal detachment persists, then you can give oral steroids. But if the chamber is very shallow, then you can even try the same viscoelastic, heavy viscoelastic. You can inject it into the anterior chamber, as I showed in the previous video. But you should consider choroidal drainage when there is a flat anterior chamber with a lens corneal touch. This is a grade 3 of the shallow chambers. And in this, and also when there is kissing choroidals, as you see in this picture. And if the hypotony is prolonged for a long period, you can even consider drainage. And this is how a choroidal drainage is done. The infratemporal quadrant is selected, and then a radial incision is made around 2.5 mm from the starting point will be 2.5 mm from the limbus. And then you can just pass the cyclodialysis spatula in the suprachoroidal space and break off all the pockets, and all the you can see the amber colored fluid coming out. So as the fluid comes out, the chamber also collapses. So you need to form the chamber each time, or you can use intracameral, I'm sorry, the anterior chamber maintainer. The late hypotony is much more serious than the early hypotony, and mostly it's because of an ischemic avascular thin bleb, or because of the overfiltration, overfiltering bleb. Because why is it a serious condition? Because this, if you you have to intervene for this late hypotony. If you don't, you will. There are chances that you would get a permanent decrease in vision. And there is a study which has shown that the single greatest predictor for the development of late hypotony was a low IOP at 1 month postoperative, and it has nothing to do with the concentration of mitomycin or the duration of mitomycin use. Yeah. What is hypotonous maculopathy? This is because of the hypotony which persists, you can get a decrease in vision. And in the fundus, when you see the fundus, you would see chorioretinal folds, optic nerve edema, and a vascular tortuosity. Sometimes that could be seen. And this, they invariably complain of a decrease in vision. And the risk factors for this are young age, myopia, very high myopes tend to develop this. And it has, studies have shown even an increased central corneal thickness is associated with hypotonous maculopathy and male gender too. Protective factors are diabetes, choroidals, and a thin central corneal thickness. So management, we can observe, you can, just like the management of overfiltration bleb, the Palmberg's compression sutures can be used, or the sutures, as I showed in that video, through the scleral flap, that also, the transconjunctival scleral flap sutures also can be put. Or autologous blood, then cautery is there, even glue has been, not glue, cautery and laser has been tried. But all these are temporary measures. The long-lasting measure is a scleral patch graft. So basically in hypotonous maculopathy, when the there is a collapse of the globe, so the sclera folds, and that is what you see as choroidal folds. So you need to remove these folds, so you have to raise the pressure so that these folds disappear. So if we leave it like that, and especially if it's beyond 6 months and you don't intervene, then there can be irreversible chorioretinal fibrosis. And whatever measure taken to raise the pressure, it's not going to improve the vision. The other cause for late hypotony is the late onset leakage. And this is mainly because of the avascular ischemic bleb. So how do you manage this? So usually the patient complains of watering, so you need to do a seedles and check whether there's a leak. This is because of the high concentration of mitomycin. That's the reason for the avascular ischemic bleb developing. So how do you treat it? So we need to excise the bleb. And the most important thing to note is you don't have to excise the entire bleb. So the entire bleb architecture need not be disturbed. We can just remove a part of the epithelium, the bleb epithelium, and then advance the healthy conjunctiva and suture it. So if you're not able to, if you don't have enough conjunctiva, then you can use a pedicle flap also is possible, pedicle conjunctival flap you can use, or autologous graft, or in, amniotic membrane also can be used. But if the flap is totally melted, then in such a situation, you have to use a scleral patch graft, and over that you can advance the conjunctiva and suture. But you need to warn the patient that the pressure is going to rise up. So here you can see the late onset bleb leak for which the scleral patch graft is being put. As always, prevention is better than cure. So what are the management tips to prevent hypotony? So any person who does a trabeculectomy surgery will definitely come across hypotony in some of their patients. So we need to err on the side of the tighter sutures, because tighter sutures can be managed by doing a suture lysis, or by if a releasable suture has been put, it can be released. But if it is if the sutures are already loose, then it's very difficult to fix this problem. Meticulous handling of tissues using a non-toothed the conjunctival forceps. Do not use toothed forceps, so that so as to prevent buttonhole. And mitomycin has to be thoroughly washed, and the conjunctival edges should not the mitomycin should not touch the conjunctival edges. And this is the reason for most of the leak happening. And whenever there, when you suspect a potential problem, you should make your post-op visits more frequent. So I generally call patients twice in a week, depending upon the status of the bleb and the eye. And so you can call accordingly. So if you're observing for any, whenever there is early hypotony, you can just observe, so call more frequently, and then intervene if necessary. So in spite of all the complications of TRAB, still it remains the mainstay. And so and post-operative hypotony should be observed and looked for. And if, especially in late hypotony, you should not leave it untreated, because it can result in permanent visual damage. Thank you.
Can I ask a question? Difluprednate drops, I found in one case useful instead of the regular steroid drops. That somehow raises the pressure in hypotony.
Yes, it's, difluprednate is better to be avoided, though the dosages, the frequency of dosage is less with difluprednate. It's known to increase pressure. So in hypotonous,
hypotonous eyes.
It's actually I have no experience. If you can ask anybody else in the panel.
Hi, I'm Jayant. I'm from Singapore National Eye Center. I think I used it when I was doing my fellowship in Wilma. Some people, there are two schools of thought here. One is to, because difluprednate is higher potency, so some people say that that can lead to a bit of steroid response resulting in higher pressure with time. Pressure. The other school of thought, which has more people believing in it, including myself, is you reduce the number of steroids, you give them a steroid holiday of sorts to allow, because many of us work on Asian eyes. I mean, all of us here, I suppose, work on Indian eyes. And scarring will usually tend to take its course, and you hasten the scarring process by giving them a 24 to 48 hour steroid holiday. For me, I think that works. And then you see them, and then that tends to work in my hand so far. But there is a school of thought where they give difluprednate purposely for the steroid response component. So both, it depends what you like to believe in. Yeah.
But there's no literature on that. Right?
So in hypotonous eyes, you try difluprednate. Is that what you're saying?
In some people do that because of steroid response. I personally prefer to give them a steroid holiday, which means I
reduce the dose, take them off steroids
for a day or two, bring them back, and then I accordingly taper back their steroids depending on what I see. That's what I do. And she reduces steroids. I think we both subscribe to this.